This video is the second part on a topic of enzyme inhibition. In the part 1, we had talked about the reversible inhibition. Now, in this video, I will talk about irreversible inhibition and allosteric inhibition. So, let's start our discussion with the irreversible inhibition. So, in this video, I will discuss about irreversible inhibition. So, in irreversible inhibition, what happens? When enzyme binds with the inhibitor, the bond forms between enzyme and inhibitor, and this bond is a covalent bond. Covalent bonds are stronger bond, so this inhibitor cannot be detached from the enzyme. So once inhibitor binds with the enzyme, this enzyme, it remains permanently inhibited. Okay, it cannot be reactivated. So now let us look at various examples of irreversible inhibition. The first example is of the DFP. The full name of DFP is the diisopropyl fluorophosphate. This compound was developed by the Germans during World War II. And this compound is also called as a now gas. Now what this compound does, this compound irreversibly inhibits enzyme acetylcholine esterase. Now normally, physiologically, what this acetylcholine esterase does, in the now synapses, there is one neurotransmitter, that is acetylcholine. This neurotransmitter is broken down to the acetate and choline. And this breaking down reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme acetylcholine esterase. Now what happens? Whenever in the now synapse, acetylcholine is secreted, what happens? Within a microsecond, acetylcholine is broken down to acetate and choline by this enzyme. But as DFP is the irreversible inhibitor of acetylcholine esterase, what will happen? This acetylcholine will permanently stay at the now synapses and it continuously stimulates its next neuron. And that is a dangerous thing, right? So because of that, ultimately the person undergoes paralysis and death occurs. Okay, so this is highly toxic compound. The second example is of the cyanide. This cyanide, it irreversibly inhibits enzyme cytochrome oxidase. This cytochrome oxidase is the enzyme of respiratory chain, right? And so if this enzyme is inhibited, respiratory chain cannot function properly and so ATP cannot be generated. Okay, and so patients or persons death occur. And because it is disturbing this respiratory chain, the cyanide is also called as a respiratory poison. The next example is of the heavy metal lead. Remember, any heavy metal in a higher concentration, it irreversibly inhibits many enzymes, right? The lead at a higher concentration, it irreversibly inhibits two enzymes. One is ferrochelatase and second one is the delta ALA dehydratase. These both enzymes are required in the pathway of heme synthesis. Right. Now, in case of irreversible inhibition, there is one special type of inhibition. It is called as a suicide inhibition. In a previous video, we had talked about the suicide inhibition as a part of competitive inhibition. Let's try to once again revisit this topic about suicide inhibition. See what happens in the suicide inhibition. Suppose this is the enzyme E and this is the inhibitor I molecule. Now what happens? This enzyme initially reversibly binds with the inhibitor molecule. And this inhibitor molecule by this same enzyme gets converted to altered product. Let's call it as a I dash. Now this altered product is an irreversible inhibitor irreversible inhibitor of the same enzyme molecule. So once again, what happened? Initially, this inhibitor is a reversible inhibitor, is a reversible inhibitor of this enzyme. But what happens once this enzyme binds with the inhibitor, this inhibitor itself gets converted to altered product, that is, we are calling it as I dash, and this altered product results into irreversible inhibition of this enzyme, and this is also a more potent inhibition, more potent inhibition. So here we can say that enzyme itself is converting its inhibitor into the more potent and irreversible inhibitor. So it looks like that enzyme itself is damaging it, right? Or you can say enzyme itself is doing a suicide. So because of that reason, this such type of inhibition is called as a suicide inhibition. The second thing, that enzyme's mechanism is converting less potent inhibitor into more potent inhibitor, right? So here enzyme's mechanism itself is responsible. So because of that reason, suicide inhibition is also known as mechanism based inhibition. See, let's look at the example. This example we had already seen during the competitive inhibition. See, there is one enzyme, it is a xanthine oxidase. And xanthine oxidase reversible inhibitor is the allopurinol. Allopurinol reversibly inhibits xanthine oxidase, and this reversible inhibition is kind of competitive inhibition. Now, once allopurinol binds with the xanthine oxidase, allopurinol gets converted to the compound alloxanthine. And this alloxanthine, it binds again with the xanthine oxidase, and that binding is irreversible. Okay, so it results into irreversible inhibition of this xanthine oxidase. So allopurinol is one of the best example of the suicide inhibition. Now let us look at the allosteric inhibition, that is the last type of enzyme inhibition. So the next topic is allosteric inhibition. To understand about allosteric inhibition, suppose this is the metabolic pathway in which A is converted to B, B is converted to C, C is converted to D, then it go on multiple step and ultimately final product Z is formed. And let's say the first enzyme is the E1, second enzyme is the E2, and third enzyme is the E3. Now here what happens? The final product, that is the Z, it inhibits the earlier step. Let's say it is inhibiting this enzyme number 2, E2. Okay, so such type of feedback inhibition is called as an allosteric inhibition. Now it is not necessary that it will inhibit only the second enzyme. It may be any of the earlier enzyme, but most of the time it is the first enzyme which gets inhibited, right? Let's look at one real life example. In case of fatty acid synthesis pathway, what happens? Acetyl coenzyme A gets converted to malonyl coenzyme A, and this reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme acetyl coenzyme A carboxylase. Now this malonyl coenzyme A goes under multiple steps and finally gives rise to fatty acyl coenzyme A. This fatty acyl coenzyme A inhibits acetyl coenzyme A carboxylase. Okay, so as you can see, the final product is inhibiting one of the earlier step of this metabolic pathway, and by this way our body regulates the production of final product, right? If final product is accumulated so much, then it inhibits its own pathway's earlier enzyme, so the further production of this final product can be stopped. We will talk more about this allosteric inhibition when we talk about enzyme regulation. So this completes the part 2 of the video of enzyme inhibition, and I hope that irreversible inhibition and allosteric inhibition is clear to you. If you have still any doubt or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below. Thank you.